Okay, another box. This one's from Zen Xiong. Oh, it's from the People's Road, Longgang, Shenzhen. What have they sent me this time? So after everything I said about, I think I pissed off the person I was working with in regards to the 3D printers, someone else turned up and decided they wanted to work again, and I thought, well, I said to them, look, this is what happened last time, and I think most people watch my videos to find out why they shouldn't buy something, not necessarily because they want that authority figure like me to kind of convince them to spend money. I don't feel like an authority figure. I mean, if you're here because you're researching this very printer, you probably already know why you want it.
Yikes!
And if you're watching this video because you know this channel, well, you probably know why you want to watch. I'll try and show this printer off in the light I think suits it best, and you can make a decision yourself whether to keep watching this channel or to purchase a 3D printer from a land far, far away. So this thing is similar to the Anycubic, as far as I can tell. This is the JGAurora A3. I need to stop throwing these away and actually start changing the plugs. Oh, quite quality sticker. I happened to watch a couple of review videos of this model of printer, one by Homofations and the other by MyFoodBoy, and I noticed they got a pair of pliers in their box. This one doesn't come with the pliers, but it's also 60 quid cheaper. But the pliers alone are not worth 60 quid. You also don't get a pair of latex gloves, a spatula or tweezers, and those are kind of essential tools when you're working with a 3D printer, I've come to discover. Before power on, please refer to the instructions in USB stick. Satisfying bit of plastic here. What you do get is a fairly curvaceous printer that looks like a game console which belongs in your kitchen. You also get 250 grams of PLA filament, a decent spool holder, some machine screws and Allen keys, and a bed that looks very similar to the Ultra Base on the Anycubic i3 Mega. Whoever goes under the abbreviation DBG, Diamond Black Glass. Essentially, this is some kind of screen printed texture on glass. Oh, and an additional nozzle in case the first one bungs up. Take out machine parts in the package, printer base, frame, filament holder, toolbox. Let printer base pass through frame. Beware of the screen. Should be the same direction as the frame. As shown in the pic, aim the A point to B point. Fix between the slot, then use large screw with shim to install it. On the other side of frame should install the filament holder using small screw, then connect the wires. Okay, on the side, and then screws under here. That's clever. You know it's quite early. What little wiring I have here doesn't feel as neat as the Anycubic. Okay, I can see something I don't like already. That looks like it's totally buggered there. These should not look like that. This should look like this. My CNC machine. Okay, so you've got this humongous power adapter. It's a 24 volt, 15 amp. It would have been nice if this was actually inside. Hate having all this sort of cabling trailing around, but it's still not bad compared to some of the early printers. You simply turn it on with this switch over here. Boom. So you do get a small spool of PLA, a quarter of a kilogram, but I'm not going to open this, or just use one that I've already got open. That fits in there, and then this goes in there. You can automatically feed the filament in using the touch display control panel, but I just pushed it through.
This printer also sports a filament runner sensor. The concept invites leaving the machine alone, but I would advise against it. Always be in close proximity in case something unusual happens.
This is really quiet, this machine. I'm really surprised.
I began by homing the machine and looking at the movement. It seems okay considering the couplers look like they've been yanked.
I'm not sure what the power rating of the stepper motors are, but again, they're smaller than the any cubic. Two tiny fans here. It's on a linear rail at the back. There, I'm assuming it's a similar thing in there. I've got no idea how you open this. I'm not sure what this board is, but it says MKS maker base. The electronics doesn't look too bad, to be honest.
There was also a thin piece of plastic which can be used to level the nozzle against the bed. The control panel has an assisted self-level option, which moves the nozzle to predetermined zones. I went through the motion several times until it felt consistent.
It's a bit too compact.
I really struggled to get my fingers in to adjust the bed height. You also want to check either side of the Z-axis so everything is parallel to the bed, and to make sure the bed and nozzle are heated to compensate for an expansion in material when calibrating the machine.
You just do this several times. I don't like the positioning of the terminal here on the hotbed. It just feels like it's a bit too close to the frame and it catches on this bit of wiring here. I'm not really sure where to push that.
I decided to print a cooling nozzle for the printer, one of possibly many prints you could do to improve the printer's performance. The first few prints, however, kept unsticking. I kept adjusting the bed height, further compressing the first layer of PLA, but that didn't seem to make any difference. In the end, I suspected the hotbed surface may be contaminated with some kind of oil, so I cleaned it with some methylated spirit, and that seemed to do the trick.
Try to print something else, and that came unstuck as well. So what I'm going to do is just wipe this with a bit of methylated spirit just to make sure there's no grease on it. I might be contributing to the pieces becoming unstuck. I know I've got a fan going on in the background, which can affect obviously the print. It might be cooling the PLA just enough for it to kind of contract and unstick off the bed, but since I read a report about particle production or release of UFP, ultrafine particles, from 3D printing, I'm kind of in the mind that it's worth having a fan on with a filter to try and collect as much of that stuff up. You know, ideally I'd like to build an enclosure for these sort of machines. Obviously it protects them against the elements of the workshop, but also contains anything that's being produced from the print.
I eventually had some success printing the nozzle for the extruder, which I found on the USB pen that came with the printer. I had to generate the G-code myself, as this was only an STL file, and I used my settings from the AnyCubic as a starting point on Repetio host. Eventually, I decided to install the software that was provided with the machine. It looks like a version of Cura with pre-configured settings for the JGAurora range of printers. It is called JGCrete, which I think is a spelling mistake and was meant to be JGCreate. If you prefer to use the latest version of Cura, which at the time of filming is 3.2.0, you can copy the .json profile files from the JGCrete installation. You'll find these in program files /jgcrete2.5.0/resources/definitions, which you'll have to copy over to program files /ultimatecura3.2/resources/definitions. Once you've done that, you can open Cura and add the printer. I also noticed that the new version of Cura has a pre-installed configuration for a few other printers, including the AnyCubic i3 Mega, which is my go-to printer. I played around with the settings in Cura until I started to get successful prints. This included raising the bed temperature to 60 degrees Celsius, which is a lot higher than I'd set for the Anycubic i3 Mega. I printed a new nozzle which can fit on both the A3S and the A5. I'll provide a link to the Thingiverse file in the description below. I noticed something unusual with the PTFE tube moving upon retraction, but it didn't seem to have any obvious effects on the print.
Okay, success! So you can print this particular nozzle on the bed of the A3S using the factory sent nozzle.
I also printed a test cube, the first layer of which was a little compressed but under extruded, so I further adjusted the settings in Cura. I'll write down the settings in the article that will accompany this video. Anyway, this printer took a little while to get used to, and despite the buggered couplers, it actually still works quite well. The unsaid rule with these printers is they are really cheap and it's really difficult to send them back because they came from a land far, far away. You might be able to get replacement parts, so double check what else is available from the supplier and just be aware you might have to fix or adapt the product. What I'll do now is also update the top 3D printer list on my website. So if you want a quick summary of the pros and cons of this and other machines, have a read of it as it may help you make a more informed decision before parting with your cash. Thanks again for watching, and in the next one, I'll be playing with this.
This monster here soon.